This is a show about one of the strangest looking birds on Earth. We're putting you in a world of pelicans so you can see how fragile yet resilient wildlife can truly be. Now, you've probably seen pelicans at the beach, but I promise you've never seen them like this. As the sun rises on a warm spring day, these pelicans seem carefree and playful as they splash in the waves off Georgia's coast. The birds have come from places further south, the Gulf of Mexico, the Caribbean, even Cuba. They have come here to nest and will soon be seeking a mate and raising their young. We are on Little Egg Island, 60 miles south of Savannah and just north of St. Simons. It is land set aside and protected under state law because of the many species that have come to depend on this as a place to nest or rest. The island is pulsing with the energy of migratory birds, some that fly thousands of miles nonstop to reach their nesting grounds in the Arctic. They need this unpopulated sand spit to refuel before making journeys that can cross a continent or span several days. Little Egg Island has also become a safe haven for the hundreds of pelicans that come each year. As you will soon learn, some of them are lucky to be alive. There are seven species of pelicans. In Georgia, we have brown pelicans, smallest in size, but still relatively large birds. Pelicans are very social and like to hang out in groups. At times, they look like wise old men gathered in their favorite coffee joint to catch the morning gossip. One head turns, they all turn. The twisting neck that makes them look so odd is due to their unique physiology. You see, the pelican's seventh and ninth vertebrae are joined together, making it impossible for them to straighten their necks. The males are slightly larger, but other than that, it's difficult to tell the sexes apart. On our first trip to Egg Island, the guys were busy trying to impress the girls. Once the female chooses her mate, he begins to bring her sticks and grass to build their nest. She accepts the gifts with a head sway. You'll see a lot of those swaying movements during this mating period. When mating, the males often use their long bills to grab the nape of the female neck. When the deal is sealed, she lays 2 to 3 eggs, white in color and a bit larger than a chicken egg. It was during this mating ritual that we spotted a red band on one bird. At the time, we didn't know it, but that band has a very special meaning. It means that this pelican was once covered in oil from the Horizon spill in 2010. Pelicans became the face of the Gulf Coast oil spill, and Louisiana birds were hardest hit. Some of the lucky ones were rescued, cleaned, and brought to Georgia. It is their state bird. It graces the state flag and had just been taken off the endangered species list a year before the spill.
It's a vital part of the coast, and it's a great symbol to this state. We're taking them out of their home habitat and trying to get them to a safer environment.
Michael Carlos speaks for Louisiana's Wildlife and Fisheries Department, which incorporated a huge network of people to save as many pelicans as possible.
Most of them were probably doomed, if not all of them, had they not been rescued. And now, you know, they've been cleaned and they're gonna start their new chapter in life to a new clean area.
By winter, Georgia biologist Tim Kies assumed the transplants would have migrated south, then returned to Louisiana to nest in the Gulf. The sighting of that red band a year later came as a big surprise.
We had about 150 oiled pelicans that had been cleaned, but were captured in the Gulf, cleaned, and then brought to the Georgia coast and released here. I was fairly sure that they would go back to the Gulf, but we've had at least 11 confirmed sightings of those Gulf birds coming back to the Georgia coast. So it certainly appears that they're nesting, and we hope to confirm that.
One question hangs in the air. They may be clean, but can they have chicks? Can they reproduce? At the time, the prevailing thought was no. When a wild bird is oiled, captured, then goes through the trauma of being scrubbed clean, studies have indicated that the stress or reaction to the oil render the bird incapable of reproduction. But we chose to be optimistic. We watched and waited. Over several weeks, the colony on Egg Island broke off into many nesting pairs. On this visit, we see that some are already sitting on eggs. Pelicans don't incubate like other birds. They use those wide, webbed feet instead of their breast.
Wow, so they actually hold their feet on top of the eggs?
Correct. They can regulate blood flow to the feet, so they can control the temperature, so that actually it's a pretty good mechanism of keeping the eggs warm.
That is part of the reason they were close to extinction. Pesticides like DDT affected a gland that controls calcium in eggs. As a result, the eggs were thin, and when pelicans stood on them, they cracked. By 1961, biologists couldn't find any nesting pelicans in Louisiana. Even after DDT was banned, it took decades to bring these birds back from the brink. With each visit, the pelican colony on Egg Island changes. As the first chicks hatch, it's hard to determine if they're adorable or ugly. You can't help but think of a plucked chicken. Through the long-range lens of a camera, you see behaviors that would normally go unnoticed. The foot-long bill with a hanging pouch is the most distinguishing feature of pelicans. But watch all the flapping. It's as if the wind is blowing right through that wrinkled skin. But the flapping serves a purpose. When they get too hot, pelicans open their bills and flutter the sides of their pouches. That movement keeps air flowing over the moist surface and regulates their body temperature. It's similar to the way we sweat when it's too hot and the evaporating water on our skin cools us down. That pouch also goes through some pretty strange stretching exercises. Pelicans throw their heads back like they're sucking in air, and sometimes they turn the pouch completely inside out. But most importantly, the pouch is used to catch fish. Brown pelicans have incredible eyesight, and they are the only pelican species that are plunge divers, which means they see fish from the air and dive head first into the water to scoop them up like a net.
And when they hit the water, they really lunge forward, and the lower mandible, they flex, so it really opens up that the pouch.
A mandible.
The lower bill.
Okay.
So they flex muscles that basically turns it from a long, skinny bill to really open that pouch.
The pouch will hold 3 gallons of fish and or water. On our next visit, it is obvious they will need every bit of that space. The chicks are getting their first feathers. Some are just covered with down and look like cuddly stuffed animals on a little girl's bed. But when it comes to food, these sweet-looking fluff balls turn into aggressive eating machines. With growth comes confidence. No longer content to sit back and wait for food, they now go pouch diving. Now, you can't go up to a wild pelican and check out its pouch, but we're taking you to a place where captive birds are used to the human touch. Save Our Seabirds is a sanctuary in Sarasota, Florida, that rehabilitates injured pelicans. But some have injuries that prevent their release.
So this is Sweet Pea, and I can see why she can't be released.
Hi there. How are you?
She's a year old. She's just about a year old. It's a little female.
This is not a fish. I'm sorry. This is not a fish. No fish. Maybe later.
This is Sweet Pea, brought in as a chick with a deformed wing that prevents her from ever flying. She is the heart of the sanctuary and spoiled rotten.
Now, what is she doing? Is she mad
she
at me?
She
is that your hint?
Fish.
Is this a hint?
Yes, they want my food.
I don't have any food, I'm sorry.
When she can't get fish from me, the camera looks like a good option. As she walks around, you can see the deformity that prevents her release.
She gets another 6 later.
Sweet Pea depends on someone to feed her. That is why rehabilitators like Lee Fox discourage people from feeding pelicans on the dock or fishing pier. When any seabird loses its fear of humans and sees them as a food source, its life is forever changed. It will stay where the people are instead of migrating south to follow the fish. And for a pelican, that can be the kiss of death.
That's one of the reasons why these birds are endangered, because they are so susceptible to being imprinted or humanized or whatever you want to call it when they get too used to people.
And that's how they get hurt, most often hooked by a fisherman. People who try to rescue injured pelicans can make it even worse. Here's why. This incredibly tolerant bird lets us hold open her bill so you can see how she breathes through this small opening called a glottis. So they can suffocate if their bill is held shut during rescue.
All right.
Now you have to hold firm, because if she decides to pull it out, you're going to get cut on your finger from see how sharp this is. Go with this hand and feel. That's sharp.
Oh yeah.
If she pulled her head out real quick, you'd wind up with something a little bit more than a paper cut.
I hear you.
Okay.
Don't do that to me, okay?
Notice that Lee has me put one finger in between the bill so the bird can always breathe. Her pouch is unexpectedly soft, almost like a baby's cheek. It's a good lesson for fishermen who may accidentally hook a bird. Once the bird is secured, the hook can easily be cut and removed. But if they just cut the fishing line, the pelican or any bird will get entangled and the hook becomes infected.
But that's another good thing for people to know. If they have a hook, don't just yank it out.
They cause more damage than if they had just cut it out and cut the barb off and taken the hook out, and that bird could have been released and not been sitting on the side of the beach dying.
Lee Fox is a tiny woman with a huge heart. Most of her time is spent here trying to save yet another pelican.
Put that wing back in there.
Oh, not going anywhere. Next.
Let me get it. You can release him. He's been here long enough, and it was a superficial wound. I remember this bird.
As each yellow band comes off, another pelican is free to go.
All right, baby, let's go. Let's go, let's go.
Three. Now we're going to test for full extension.
So this is where the fishing line was embedded.
Was rubbing and rubbing and rubbing to the point.
And she couldn't get it off.
Right. It gets wrapped around this area here, which is the inside of your elbow. It's called the patagium. Once that skin is broken, the monofilament line can go through and hit the nerve and the tendon. Once that is severed and the bird can't make an extension and his wing will droop, he is not going to be able to fly, which renders him a permanent.
But this one looks okay.
This one looks fine. He's got 100% extension.
So Y6 is clear to go.
Yep.
There are 12 in all. The last bird to be released had also been trapped by fishing line that could have caused her to lose a leg. But months later, here she is, ready to go. It's time to get back to our Georgia colony again. And it's worth the wait. This time, we see a little miracle. One of the previously oiled birds that could have easily died is standing over her chicks, dashing the theory that oiled birds cannot reproduce. Pelican 28Z was captured on June 20, 2010, treated at Fort Jackson, Louisiana, and released in Brunswick, Georgia on July 1st that same year. Seven more nests with oiled birds produced chicks with a grand total of 17 babies. Now for the next big test, are the chicks healthy? Veterinarian Terry Norton performs physicals on chicks from both oiled birds and those from unoiled parents.
All the chicks look healthy to me. They didn't.
And when the tests came back, the blood work proved that observation correct. Chicks from previously oiled pelicans were as healthy as any. There were at least 17 chicks from oiled birds. But how could they be so healthy? Why did these chicks beat the odds? A new method of cleaning oiled birds could be the key to success. Dr. Erica Miller with Tri-State Bird Rescue in Delaware spent about 6 months in the Gulf cleaning birds and overseeing the operation. The workload was overwhelming.
Fortunately, I guess, you don't have time to think about the poor bird. And we're not sitting home and watching it on the television and feeling the emotion of the bird involved and all this. We're like, we got 10 more we got to take care of. You know, they just called, they're bringing in 75 more. And we had days at Fort Jackson where they were bringing in over 100 a day for several days in a row.
20 years ago, a pelican would be washed right after capture. Well, now they give the bird time to calm down, and they give it fluids to flush out any oil that may have been swallowed. But the real breakthrough is what you might call a corn oil cocktail. Instead of scrubbing off the oil, pelicans are soaked in a chemical that's part vegetable oil and part alcohol. In a pinch, even canola oil will do. Bottom line, oil breaks down oil. Now, the Bath and Dawn dishwashing liquid is less abrasive. Miller shows us how it works. First, she tests a few breast feathers to get the soap strong enough to tackle the oil. But watch what happens when the oil breaks down and the soap is rinsed off. The feather is dry.
When the oil gets in between there, it messes up the structure. And now when you've got it, get all the detergent off and you've got a fluffy, dry feather.
That is amazing. It feels dry. That is amazing.
Yeah.
Back on Little Egg, we watch another beautiful sunrise, knowing it's about time for the season to end. Adolescent pelicans are beginning to leave the nest and try out their wings. They still need a little support, but instinct is kicking in. And they seem to know their days with mom and dad are numbered. At this stage, it's as if the adults are saying, "This is your last free meal, kiddo." Like a group of teenagers, they waddle around, flapping their wings, ready to leave the nest. They are about to start a journey of their own. It's been a year since we followed those pelicans, and our story was going to end here back on Little Egg Island because they returned to nest again this spring. But it didn't work. This time, Mother Nature got in the way. Tim Kies and I walked through what used to be a large colony of nesting pelicans, at least 500 pairs. But when a tropical storm hit the island, the birds abandoned their nests and all the eggs.
All that work for nothing.
Yep.
It's nest after nest after nest. Yeah. Hopefully they'll come again next year.
Yeah, I think they will. I think they will. They're nesting here for years, and they've had colonies collapse in years past, and they've come right back the next year, so hopefully they'll continue. Hopefully we'll get a little building this winter.
It is disappointing, especially since some of those gulf birds came back to nest again. But not all is lost. Tim found another colony near Cumberland Island. And there are the telltale red bands. Oiled birds from the gulf are still alive and nesting once more. They're reproducing, they're having chicks. Nature's cycle will soon repeat itself as those chicks grow up and fly south for the winter. Pelicans are hard not to love. They look like something from the dinosaur age when they fly, with a wingspan of about 7 feet and those necks tucked back against their shoulders. They glide in a V formation, sometimes in a single line, just above the water. It's almost impossible to imagine a world without them. Famous aviator Charles Lindbergh once said, "If I had to choose, I would rather have birds than airplanes." He must have been watching pelicans. The brown pelican, because of its recovery from near extinction, has a special significance for a lot of folks. It is naive to think we'll never have another oil spill or catastrophic event, but time and time again, this bird has shown it has the ability to survive. I'm Sharon Collins. We'll see you next time.